You know, the one thing that my coach got right that night was that, well, all of us are going to die. The mortality rate is still 100%. And if you're looking for job security, well, then working at a funeral home is probably as good a bet as any, right? But here's the deal. Death isn't the lens through which we enter discipleship. Life is. Life is. And this is something that the Apostle Paul knew so well, maybe better than anybody. Now, when we catch up with Paul in our reading for today, he's in prison with one of his friends, Timothy. And he's writing to the church he planted in Philippi, which is in Greece. Now, the opening part of his letter isn't some kind of like theological treatise. It's really dissimilar from what we get from him in Romans. Instead, it's the reflections of a lifelong pastor to a community he loves. And so what we have is more like a journal. And in his reflections, in his journal, he gives us some hints as to how we ought to approach our lives of discipleship today. And so let's take a look into his letter to the church at Philippi in the book of Philippians, chapter 1, 12 through 14, and then skip into 20 to 30. Now, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I'm in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I'm to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. You know, what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I'll remain, and I will continue with you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you, again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come see you or only hear about you in my absence, I'll know that you stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, since you are going through some of the same struggles you saw I had. But now hear that I still have the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So what's the first thing that Paul teaches us about how to approach our lives of discipleship through a lens of life and not death? Well, the first step is to make peace with the past. You know, I love what he has to say in verse 12. He says, "And I want you to know, my dear friends, that everything that has happened here has helped to spread the good news." Now, did I mention that Paul is in prison? And I don't suppose that it's anything like Club Fed, right? Now, we only get a drop in the ocean of Paul's inner monologue. I mean, we get a lot of text in the New Testament, but not nearly as much as we probably could. But we can imagine that during his time in prison, he's got to be wondering about the road that brought him there. You know, I think that it suffices to say, like, if you have anything in prison, it's time. And time to think about your choices and the road that brought you to that point. You know, whenever I think about the pitch, you know, remember the "what happens if you die on your way home" pitch I heard when I was a kid? And gosh, the countless iterations of that same pitch I've heard over the years, a central part of the picture is fear of your past. I mean, how many of you, when you were a little kid, heard the one about getting to heaven, and then God pulls out this filing cabinet of all the bad things you've done in your life? Well, the idea is something like, you know, what happens if God opens that up? You can't change your past, so, well, what now? I may feel this more acutely than most, but I often wonder if I'm good enough, you know, in God's eyes to do what I do, to be a pastor. You know, you may not know, but I think a lot of people that do this work struggle with imposter syndrome. You know, something like, what if they find out I'm not who they think I am? Or what if they find out that I've done most of the things I tell them not to? Or what if they find out that they know more stuff than I'm supposed to know? Well, what if they find out that I'm super lucky that social media didn't exist when I was in college? Well, more importantly, what if God finds out? What if God knows all that stuff? Well, Paul isn't a saint. Actually, based on what we know about his past, he is absolutely the kind of guy we would lock up and probably throw away the key. But that isn't his perspective, is it? When he looks at his situation and the road that brought him to it, what he sees isn't the accumulation of debt on a scale he could never tip on his own, but the culmination of steps on a journey that God has been leading him on to a fuller version of himself. And as a result, he's made peace with the past. Now, peace in the Bible isn't to whitewash or to excuse what's been done, but to let it be what it is. It is to integrate the brokenness in our life into the whole. It is to do what God does with creation, taking chaos into order and making something very good, thereby making peace with our past. So the second way to enter into discipleship from a perspective of life and not death is by trusting in the future. So later in the text, Paul says some things that I think are evidence of him sharing in the mind of God. That is to say, evidence of Paul having deep wisdom. So it reflects on life and death. And listen again to what he says in verses 20 to 25. He says, "I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now as always Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I'll remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith." Does this sound like a person who is scared of the future? Absolutely not. You see, Paul trusts the future because he trusts in Christ. And how profoundly so. You know, he isn't going out on a morphine drip. He is anticipating much worse than that. Like, here he is, though, hemming and hawing about either way. Well, there's been so much ink spilled about what death is like. And unfortunately, I think that the church has done a wonderfully ironic job of encouraging us to be wildly at peace while also being properly terrified of dying. Now, a few weeks back, my son celebrated his 10th birthday. He celebrated with about a dozen of his buddies. And surprising no one, he wanted to celebrate with a pool party. I think he may be half fish. Well, as little boys are wont to do, the swimming evolved from complaining about how cold the water was to a water gun fight to chicken to the inevitable belly flop contest. And so the gaggle of them got into a line behind the diving board and started doing what, you know, they do. So the first kids went in, no problem. And then we got to one of his buddies who I could tell was maybe a little bit nervous. And so just before he went, he jumped out of line to go get his goggles. You can't jump in without goggles. Well, some other kids went, and then it was his turn again, and then he jumped out of line and grabbed his water wings, because just in case. Well, then it was his turn a third time, and thanks be to God, the boys found the water guns, because that dude wasn't going to go in the water. Now, I tell you that to tell you this. I think Paul understands death not like jumping into the inky blackness of nothing. I think that the text tells us is that he expects it to be like jumping into the cool embrace of the water of life with all those that have gone before and will come after us. And I think that rather than Jesus being the one that shoves us into the water, Jesus is more the diving board ushering us through with some joy and air to spare. Though I think we, like my son's friend, often approach it like that first picture, and maybe sometimes worse. Not only is there inky blackness, but there's also judgment to deal with, and so we try to shove enough religion into our days to make up for our past. We try to outserve Mother Teresa so that we can look like one of the good guys when the time comes, and often we just avoid the idea of death altogether. Well, friends, the good news that Paul is talking about here is that Jesus has made a way for us through death into life. You know, Hebrews talks about Jesus being the pioneer of our faith, making a way for us. You know, Jesus has met and defeated death and has extended a hand back to us in our present moment so that we would hold on to it and trust it as we move forward. Not inch by inch, but in one big leap into something new. So the final way that Paul encourages us to approach our lives is to be citizens of the present. Citizens of the present. You know, the way that he puts it in the text is to be a citizen of heaven. And if we're taking Jesus at his word, then the kingdom of heaven is right here, right now. I mean, isn't he saying, behold, the kingdom of God is near, right? So, carpe diem. Well, one of the things that I do when I go to people's houses is I scope out the bookshelves. I'm that guy. And it isn't because I'm trying to be judgy about what you do or don't read. It's because I'm socially awkward and I'm like doing whatever I can to find something to talk about. And I think books give you a pretty good idea of where to start. Well, if you were to come to my house and do the same thing, then you might lead a conversation with me by suggesting a good therapist. Because you'd see books on making sense of childhood trauma, how to organize your house in 365 days, designing your work life, and how to avoid Alzheimer's, and how to die well. Like a lot of you, I'm in one of those highly leveraged portions of life. I'm in midlife. I'm finally making sense of what was going on in my family system when I was 10, while also realizing that I have a son who is 10, while also realizing my parents have 10 to 25 years left. I'm finally getting good at my work while needing to decide what to do with my work, while also making sure I have enough work to retire so that one day I can stop working. I feel like I'm everywhere and nowhere all at once. Well, when we're unable to make peace with our past or trust in our future, we tend to vacate our present. We stop participating, and it isn't exclusively our culture's fault. I think it's highly influenced by how we imagine our relationship to God. But what we learn from Paul is what we gain from Jesus, and that is that right now and right here is where our lives are happening. Like I said, behold, the kingdom of God is at hand. Certainly you are with me in paradise. What if we embraced our present in that way? What if we as individuals could be fully present with our loved ones and the big issues of our world right now? What if we as a church could also be fully present and participate in the world at this current moment? Well, then I think we might start to see what Paul talks about. A church that shines brightly for Christ, a lamp worth putting on a stand, or a church on a hill that shows people a vision for discipleship that isn't about fear, but is about faith in Jesus. You know, in my time in family ministry here at Prince of Peace, I've had way more conversations than I care to number with students who are recovering from the pitch, just like I had. That is, they're unsure and fearful about their relationship to God. And truth be told, we have numerous conversations as a staff and as a denomination about how to communicate in a way that is as effective as scaring people into heaven. I know that it isn't as quick. I know that we won't be able to sing a few songs and raise hands on our way to chicken wings like I did some 23 years ago, but we can let our lives speak. And the way that we make peace with our past, and the way we trust our future, and in the way we are citizens of our present, we can demonstrate the truth of what we know by being the life-filled, life-animated Church of Christ right here and right now. And I think that for all people, no matter where they are coming to into their lives of discipleship, that would be good news and a pitch worth sharing. Amen.